Christ is risen from the dead, trampling over death by death. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave. Christ is risen from the dead, we are one with him again. Come awake, come awake, come and rise up from the grave.
Time to study the Bible. Let's go to Mark 14. We're trucking along and looking ahead at what we have left. I thought we were coming to a quick close, but I'm mistaken because these last three chapters are quite lengthy. Chapter 14's got 72 verses. Chapter 15's got 47 and on from there. So I thought that we would try and move through these last three chapters in the last three weeks that I've got before I'm gone for just a bit, but I don't think that that's going to happen. We're going to take it nice and slow today, 9 verses. So at that pace, we'll be done with Mark sometime in 2015, 16, I don't know. But we're going to be in Mark chapter 14, starting a new chapter anyway. And what we have here in chapter 14, of course, if you've been here for any length of time, you're well aware of the fact that we're moving through Jesus' life and all of the events that entailed that. We're moving very closely now to his death. We're in the last few days of his death. They're plotting his execution and how they can perhaps get rid of him, all his enemies are, and really trying to push him out of the scene. Things are really culminating now in these last days of his life and ministry. And we'll just jump right into verse 1 where it says, after 2 days, it was Passover and the Feast of Unleavened Bread. So the chief priests and scribes sought how they might take him by trickery and put him to death, speaking of Jesus, of course. But they said, well, not during the feast, lest there be an uproar of the people. So here now, this gives us a little bit of a stage upon which the final drama, at least of chapter 14, is set. And what we have going on here is Passover. Passover time is a very significant time in Jewish culture. This has been a long-going annual festival that has been celebrated through generations all the way back for even thousands of years. It is, if anything, I could liken it to our Thanksgiving. It's something that we do every year. It's a national commemoration of historical events. It is very specific to our culture. It even has its own meal that accompanies it. I mean, you guys know how this works. Thanksgiving dinner, what do we have? Shout it out. What do we got? Turkey. What else? Stuffing. Cranberry sauce, mashed potatoes, grandma's three-bean casserole or whatever, you know. You've got all of these. These are staple things. If it's like you're in sin if you don't have turkey and cranberry sauce. I mean, something's wrong with you. You didn't grow up in America. So we have our very specific menu. They had a very specific menu. Theirs consisted not of turkey but of lamb, which is a very significant Jewish meat because it's both prophetic and traditional. The lamb was to be sacrificed at their Passover, and this was happening for years and years and years before Jesus showed up, and Jesus, of course, was the official and final sacrificial lamb. So their meal consisted of lamb. It also consisted of bitter herbs to correspond with their bitter history as slaves in Egypt. So when they ate the bitter herbs on their annual festival, they would remember those bitter days of bondage and slavery that God delivered them from. They would foresee this sacrificial lamb that would take away their sins. And then also there was flatbread that would go along with that. Flatbread meaning no yeast in it. Okay, sandwich bread has yeast in it. It blows up nice and fluffy. You cook it, you slice it. But flatbread without yeast stays flat. And the reason that they would have that is because God, when he called them out of Egypt, said, when this happens, it's going to go down fast. I'm going to call you in the middle of the night, perhaps, and so you're going to have to be ready to go. Don't dawdle. Don't even cook with yeast because that takes time. You have to. If you've ever cooked with yeast, you know you mix the dough, you put it in the bowl, and it's got to be set in the sun or somewhere warm with a cloth over it so that it takes a few hours. God says, don't even bother with that. During that week, just use flatbread because when it's time to go, it's going to be time to go. And biblical history records that when it was time to go, it was time to go. God came calling and they had to up and move or their lives would be in severe jeopardy. So that's their meal. And this was all observed even in the day of Jesus as a commemoration of God's work in the past when God delivered them from slavery. And here in the first two verses here, you see that it's Passover. And they're plotting how they might put Jesus to death. And by the way, Jesus is God. That's a doctrine that we insist on here in this church because it's a biblical doctrine and we kind of like the Bible here. And so Jesus being God, it's so ironic that at Passover time, when they're supposed to be commemorating the salvation that God gave to them, they're actually plotting how they might kill the God that gave it to them. It's just wild to me how God doesn't change, but hearts do. I mean, this is the same God who in their own history, way back in national history, go back thousands of years, this is the gracious and merciful God that delivered them from sin and slavery, delivered them from bondage and pain and suffering, and they loved him and they worshiped him, you know, for a little bit. But over time, hearts changed. And then this God shows up in their lives thousands of years later, and they want to kill him. But it's the same God. And God hasn't changed at all. And the Bible reminds us, both Old Testament and New Testament, that God doesn't change. He's the same yesterday as he is today. And he's going to be that way forever, it says in Hebrews 13:8. Malachi 3:6 tells us again in the Old Testament that God doesn't change. But hearts do. When I say hearts, I don't mean do-do-do-do. What I mean is the essence of who you are. We're very fickle in our hearts. Human beings are. I'm not trying to accuse you or make you feel bad. We just come off of a nice weekend camping together and liking each other. And now all of a sudden I'm like, you know, a mean guy. It's not that way. You have to understand that this is common to all men and women everywhere. Hearts are fickle. Fickle meaning they vacillate, they flip-flop really fast. We can love Jesus today and then curse him tomorrow. That's how easily that comes. We can praise him today and fault him tomorrow. It's the nature of our sinful condition. And so here we see these men at Passover time, when the whole nation is celebrating their God, scheming how by trickery they might kill that God. It's just weird to me, isn't it? I mean, what if we got all gathered together this Christmas with gifts for one another? We have a tree downstairs, which will never happen, you know. Garland and wreath. No, I'm not saying it will never happen. She's like, yes, taking notes. He said, no. We all gather together at Christmas and we're doing the traditional Christmas stuff and we're supposed to be celebrating Jesus' birthday, but what if we all gather together in a common theme of how we could, like, you know, reject him fully and finally? Like, couldn't you pick a different day of the year? Does it have to happen on Christmas? We're going to reject Christ? Like, there's some things that are, you know, like, killing God on Christmas would be a bad idea. Killing God at Passover, that's probably just, it's such an oxymoron, isn't it? You celebrate the one you're killing. And as I said, hearts are fickle, and this can happen even in church. Now, isn't it true that this is a place of worship where we come together and praise God both in song and worship him in our study of his word? And yet, isn't it true that we can come together under that guise, yet with the wrong heart, that in truth, throughout the week, is seeking to silence him because he keeps convicting my conscience, and I'm sick of the guilt, and I want to keep doing what I want to do, and so we play that hypocritical sort of individual that we read about in the first two verses, and it's really no different. This happened 2,000 years ago. Ours is happening today. This was a couple of Pharisaic men, scribes, and priests, but today it's us. And again, I'm not accusing us, but I will tell you that you can so easily fall into this trap and never think yourself to be a Pharisee at all. Okay, I'm not a Pharisee. That's the bad guys in the Bible. I'm the good guy. Do you know that there's no good guys in the Bible? So if you think you're the good guy, you're wrong. Because Jesus is the only good guy. And if you start saying that you're Jesus, we're going to ask you to leave. If anybody wants to start saying, well, I'm Jesus, I'm perfect, I'm good, it's always a mistake in a church like this to start claiming to be Jesus. Just saying. So if you think you're Jesus, just keep it to yourself. So that's what we have going on here. It's Passover time. Time for the Feast of Unleavened Bread, which I already explained. It's Thanksgiving dinner. And these guys are sitting around the table, and I don't know if they're eating together, but, you know, it's Passover, it's the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and they're discussing how they might put Jesus to death. Now you go on to verse 3, and the scene completely shifts. The scene completely changes here. It says, and being in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, talking about Jesus, he's at the table, a woman came having an alabaster flask of very costly oil of spikenard, and she broke the flask, and she poured it on his head, which is a sign of great admiration, a sign of extreme honor. It's also a sign of just straight hospitality. This was a very common gesture in Israel. When you would have a guest over or you would be in the company of someone to be honored, you would oftentimes have oil, perfume set aside to anoint them. Now, it wasn't usually a whole bucket full like we have here. It was normally just a little bit, a dab, you know, anoint, I don't know where, forehead, hair, neck, something, you know, just, it's a nice smelling thing. And in days before roll-on, you know, deodorant, this was a pleasant thing. And I'm sure everybody in the home appreciated, you know, a host that would provide some deodorant, okay? So this was hospitality at its best. Okay? And this was normal. However, what she's doing is abnormal. She takes, and we'll get into this a little bit, a whole bottle full of this stuff. And I don't know what the volume of it is, but it's a substantial amount. And she pours it over Jesus. This is obviously a pretty favored occasion for this woman. She sees Jesus truly as a guest of honor. And it says that they're sitting around the table. Apparently they're having dinner. They're having their own Passover meal, complete with turkey and, flatbread and lamb. So they're sitting around having conversation, enjoying a meal. And note the contrast between verses 1 and 2 and what we have here. You have some men over here whose conversation at the Feast of Unleavened Bread is focused upon Jesus and how they might kill him. Over here at Simon's house, their conversation is likewise focused around Jesus, but how they might honor him. So you've got two very similar things going on, but very contrasted with their intent. And so we have two different dinners, two different celebrations, two different intentions. In verse 3, it tells us that they were in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper. Leper. He's not a current leper. If he still had the disease, he wouldn't be hosting a party. Okay? Lepers weren't allowed to have guests. And even if they were, you would probably reject the invitation when you got it in the mail. Wouldn't you? You get an invitation, you open it up, oh, Simon's house, party this Friday. Doesn't he have leprosy? Yeah. Well, isn't that really contagious? Yeah. And wouldn't his whole house be infected? Yeah. You know, RSVB, sorry, no. You know, you don't even want to lick the envelope on that one. Just so Simon has leprosy, or rather had leprosy. Something happened by which he was cured of an incurable disease. You know, that medicine had not found a cure at that point. And Jesus, of course, being the God that he is, was able to, through contact with Simon, apparently heal him. And so Simon is pretty stoked about that, as would you and I. You know, you got a terminal disease, and suddenly Jesus is like, ping, cured. Nice. You want to come over Friday? It's Passover. I can cook for you. I'd like to cook for you. Please. I'm going to invite friends. Lazarus will be there, the guy you raised from the dead. I'm sure he wants to come. Yeah. Mary and Martha will be there. They just love you, right? Come over to my house. I'll clean. Promise. Right? So Jesus is there, and Simon, but now even though he's cleansed of his disease, it's interesting that he still got the tag, right? The surname, the nickname, Simon the leper. He doesn't have leprosy anymore. Like, come on, get over it. Can I have a different nickname? I'm not a leper. You don't have to call me Simon the leper all the time. But he still forever is immortalized in Scripture as Simon the leper. And there's a lot of Simons in the Bible. I think there's maybe close to, well, I don't even want to say it because I'm not sure, but there's many. And Simon was a really common name in Israel. Very common. And we do read of many different Simons. Peter, by the way, was a Simon. Simon the sorcerer, another one. Here's Simon the leper. I think there was a Pharisee, a leader of the Pharisees named Simon. You see this scattered throughout the New Testament. But this Simon is referred to as the leper so that we know which one he is. And it's interesting that he's referred to as Simon the leper because then neither he nor anyone who knows him will ever forget what Jesus did for him. It will be impossible for him to ever forget what life was like before he ever came in contact with Christ. You were a leper. Don't forget that. I mean, how would you like that to be your nickname? What if we gave you a surname that identified you as whatever you were before you came to Christ? You know, like, here comes Johnny the Meth Head. Like, ah! You know, here comes Bobby the Slot. Like, geez. You know, derogatory. Like, I don't want to be known as a tramp or a heroin addict or a, you know, gambler, foul mouth, here comes so-and-so with the And there's some sins in our culture that are a little more acceptable than others. I mean, what about those, the ones that nobody accepts yet? Here comes so-and-so, the pedophile. But I don't do that anymore. Yeah, but you did. See, sometimes we want to just put away what God saved us from and just pretend like it was never us. You know? Like, I never did drugs, I never slept around, I never did those things. And God's like, don't forget where you came from. Don't forget what he's brought you from. Because then, you know what happens is we start to become like sort of ungrateful, a little too comfortable, a little less thankful. But if we can remember, and I'm not saying dwell on it, because I think some people need to move on from who they were. I mean, you know, you're not an alcoholic anymore. You're a Christian. But at the same time, don't forget how bad it was before you knew Christ. So here we see Simon, this leper. And as I said before, Lazarus was there. Mary and Martha were there. Here in Mark, it doesn't tell us their names, but there's a parallel account in John chapter 12 where it does tell us that Lazarus is there. And of course, Lazarus is the guy that Jesus brought back from the dead. And Mary is the one who broke the oil and poured it over his head. And her sister Martha is there as well. The disciples are obviously there. This includes Judas, though we won't read of him today. We'll get to him next week, and probably others. So this is a fairly extensive celebration, and they're all gathered there together to honor Christ. Now, if we look again at verses 3 through 5, we'll read it. It says, "And being in Bethany at the house of Simon the leper, as he sat at the table, a woman came having an alabaster flask of very costly oil of spikenard. Then she broke the flask and poured it on his head." Now, verse 4 says, "But there were some who were indignant among themselves and said, 'Why was this fragrant oil wasted? For it might have been sold for more than 300 denarii and given to the poor.' And they criticized her sharply." Now, when we read those English words, "they criticized her sharply," this is a little bit more graphic than that. We could just kind of come and go through this verse and think, well, they were just being mean to her. It's a word that indicates their nostrils were flaring like an angry bull that's pawing at the dirt, and they were just furious with her for doing this. And as I said before, John 12 reveals that this woman was Mary, who is Martha's sister and also Lazarus's sister. So it's obvious here that Jesus, having brought her brother back from the dead, is a much appreciated act of kindness as far as she's concerned. And so she doesn't care, apparently, how she's going to be received by the company. She just wants to honor Jesus. So she makes a mad dash into the scene, because women weren't allowed in the company of a group like that except for to serve food and drinks and whatever else is needed. Women were not allowed in that kind of a social setting. This was for the men. Yet here she comes. Here she comes with her bottle, and this is a bottle that had no top. It would have to be broken. The marble bottle would have been broken at the top. She would have dumped it over his head. I believe in John 12 it says that she began wiping his hair with her feet and just worshiping him, creating quite a scene. And you know how the disciples are when it comes to stuff like this. They hate being interrupted. "We were having a session here." And then there's a bunch of kids, you know, and the kids, and Jesus is like, "Kids are people too. Like, don't stop them from..." And now here we have Mary interrupting things. And these disciples are like, "We were getting good information from him. What are you doing here? Get back in the kitchen." And Jesus has no problem with this at all. Mary is an interesting individual. We see her several times throughout the Gospels, and every time we see her, she's sitting at Jesus' feet, listening to what he has to say, learning from his wisdom, hanging on his every word. I mean, this is a woman who was just hungry for truth and hungry for the presence of Christ, and when he was there, she would just wouldn't let him go. And it shows, actually. It shows that she was a woman who hung on every word of Christ, because here she's displaying a far more mature method of worship and a far greater depth of devotion than anyone else in the room. Her worship and her devotion surpassed anyone else in the company of Christ at that very time, including his disciples. They accuse her of spending so much on him. You could have used this to help poor people. Don't you know how much this bottle is worth? Of anybody in the room, I bet you Mary was the one who really knew what that bottle was worth. Don't you know this could have been sold for 300 denarii? What's a denarii? Well, one denarii would be one day's wage. So 300, working 52 weeks a year, 6 days a week, would have been about a year's wage. It's a lot of money for a woman to have. For a woman who, I don't believe anywhere in Scripture there's made mention of her being married. She lives with her brother. If she's married, that's awkward. You know, you're living with your siblings still, and you gotta, I ain't doing that. I ain't moving in with my sister. Forget it. So here's this single woman, presumably single, I won't assume that, but seems to be. A woman, not a man. Don't know if she works or where she works or how much money she makes if she does. Taking a full year's wage. Okay, depending on where you work, what kind of a job you have, this is $10,000 at whatever minimum wage is. What would that be, 12 or 15 a year? I don't know. $20,000 a year, $30,000 a year. Could you imagine just throwing $30,000 at Jesus' feet and going, "You're worth it, man. This is heavy duty." And she's not going to get it back, because once that bottle's broken and that oil is dumped out, it's done. It's done. And she could have gotten away with just a dab and still been considered hospitable. It would have passed the test. She would have got a passing grade for that. But she doesn't want to. Jesus is worth more than that to her, and so she spares no expense. Why? Where did she ever get that? Because wouldn't you like that? Wouldn't you like to be that kind of person who spares no expense when it comes to Christ? But isn't it true that sometimes in your heart you do hold back? Isn't that true? Like, come on, we all have to say yes, because it's true of all of us. We hold back. But if we've got the Holy Spirit in us at all, there's this thing in us that wants to spare no expense like her, and we read a story like this, and it's like, yeah. And then when it comes down to it, practically, we're like, no. Why? Well, listen, what has Jesus done in her life? I've already said it. Bringing her brother back from the dead, she's seen the power of Christ firsthand. The Bible would put it this way. She's tasted of the things of God. She's been enlightened by the Holy Spirit. She has tasted of the good things of His Word, like all that stuff. How could she turn back? And how could she spare any expense when she's seen such power and magnificence as she's seen in Christ, her friend and Lord? Well, she spares no expense, but apparently everybody else around her is a little bit upset about this. And I think the reason for that is because they do hold back. So you can always expect that individuals who serve God for gain are going to be bothered by somebody who spares no expense on Jesus Christ. Because that person just did what I know I should be doing. And so I tend to, whether it be through words or in my heart only, try to knock them down a little bit, because then it puts me on the same level again. I mean, they just outdid me, and I'm uncomfortable by that, because I know I should be living my life sparing no expense. And so they unload and they let her have it. And I like this in verse 6. It really gives us a glimpse into Jesus' heart and character. Jesus jumps in and says, "Leave her alone. Let her alone. Why do you trouble her? She's done a good work for me." I mean, this, The picture here is these men just flaring their nostrils in fury and anger for what she's done. She's interrupted them again. She has wasted all of this money. They could have done something better with this money. Like, you're just a woman. Like, get out of here. And Jesus goes, leave her alone. Like, you would think in that culture, you would have expected a man like Jesus to join the argument with his companions over here, but not Jesus, because he's more than a man, he's God. And so being God, he defends. He steps in to defend her because that's in his nature. Jesus defends those who serve him. And let me say this, if you're going to serve Jesus the way that the Bible reveals, you're going to look foolish. You're going to look foolish to the people around you. If you want to be a Christian and you want to follow Christ, people will mock you because you're going to start looking a little bit stupid in their eyes. It's just the way it goes. But it's okay if we look a little bit stupid because we have a God who protects us. Here we see Jesus protecting and defending this woman. Romans 8:33, it says, who will bring any charge against those whom God has chosen? It is God who justifies. Who's going to bring a charge against me? I'm a Christian and I serve the Lord. You think I'm an idiot? You can think that. But there will come a day when I'm vindicated. See, the world here can mock me for my devotion to Christ. They can ridicule me for the choices that I make in this life. And I will be humiliated and I will be ridiculed and we will be accused, Christians. But we will also be vindicated by a God who will not let his children drown in verbal and physical abuse. We will be vindicated on the day that Jesus Christ does actually come back through the clouds on a white horse, takes us out of this world, destroys it with fire. We will be vindicated because we will be ruling with him. And there will be all of those who were mocking us, and we will be judging and ruling over them. We will be vindicated. In the time being, we'll look foolish, we'll be mocked. For the time being, this woman looked like an absolute bonehead, just dumped a year's wage over Jesus' head, totally unneeded. What did you do that for? And yet she's vindicated. Because listen to what Jesus says here. You have the poor with you always, and whenever you wish, you may do them good. But me, you do not have always. She has done what she could. She has come beforehand to anoint my body for burial, speaking of his impending death. Assuredly, I say to you, here's her vindication. Assuredly, I say to you, wherever this gospel is preached in the whole world, what this woman has done will also be told as a memorial to her. And also, their reaction also stands as a memorial to them. But this woman is vindicated for her actions. She loved Jesus and she spared no expense, and she was ridiculed 2,000 years ago, and 2,000 years later we're talking about her in church and she's our example. Crazy, huh? Just this foolish chick barging in on a gathering that she didn't belong in and doing something as ridiculous as throwing her life savings down the drain, is still being talked about today and being set forth as the example. Jesus says, wherever the gospel is preached in the whole world, wherever the gospel is preached, so this woman and her actions actually become part of the gospel. She is finding herself in the gospel and all over the world and forever. I mean, this is insane. For this woman to be memorialized in the gospel all over the world forever. And the reason is because she gave everything she had to Jesus before it was too late. Those are three very important points. She gave everything. That's why she fits into the gospel, and that's why people all over the world are being changed by her testimony, and that's why it's eternal, because she gave everything and held nothing back. Another reason she's being memorialized is because she gave it to the right guy. She gave it to the right person. Some people are giving everything. You know that, right? Some people are giving everything to the wrong person or the wrong thing. We're sacrificing our health to pleasure. We're sacrificing our money to ungodly endeavors. We're sacrificing... Is it making a buzz or something? Okay. She gave everything to Christ. Guys, this is very important. We have to understand that we can give everything we've got. And I'll say this, you are giving everything you have somewhere. Is it to Christ? Where is it going? And she did it before it was too late. She gave everything. She gave it to Jesus. And she did it, according to his own words, what she could. She gave everything to Jesus before he was gone. And guys, it's a limited time offer that we can really live radically, if I might borrow the term from our neighboring pastor there. It's a limited time offer. There will come a day when it's no longer available to us to give everything that we have. There will come a day when we will no longer able to exhaust ourselves for the work of Christ. That's why Jesus said, the night's coming soon when no one's going to be able to work. So we need to work while we can. We need to give everything that we can while we can to Jesus, who is worthy. She has a place in the gospel. I think that's thrilling. It really is. It's thrilling to have your place in the gospel. We're so accustomed to preaching the gospel and learning the gospel and all the rest. But do you have your place in the gospel? Well, she does. And the reason she does is because her actions here very clearly illustrate the expected response to the gospel. How do you react to the gospel? The gospel, the good news, that God is righteous and just and has found a way to clear your name from all sin forever through his Son who he sacrificed. If that isn't good news, I don't know what is. What's your reaction to the gospel? Hers? Spare no expense. She understood something, I think, that very few people will understand. It's Jesus who fulfills us. Not the stuff we have, not the people we know, not the places we might happen upon, not the things that we do, but Jesus Christ satisfies. I'll read you a list of verses here. Proverbs 14:14 says, a good man will be satisfied from above. Psalm 107, verse 9 says that God satisfies the longing soul. Jesus says in John 6:35, I am the bread of life. He who comes to me will not hunger, and he who believes in me will never thirst. Isaiah 58:11 says, the Lord will guide you continually and satisfy your desire in scorched places and make your bones strong. And you shall be like a watered garden, like a spring of water, whose waters do not fail. Jeremiah 31, verse 14 says, my people shall be satisfied with my goodness, declares the Lord. What satisfies you? Or what is satisfying you? Or where are you finding your satisfaction? Because Jesus says to us, if we're finding it in any other place other than him, it may be somewhat satisfying, but it's not full satisfaction. And he's promised us full satisfaction and full joy. He says, I have come so that your joy may be full. In other words, if you don't have Christ and you're not serving Christ and you're not giving all for Christ, your joy is partial. Your joy is incomplete. And I'm not saying you're not joyful. You can... The Bible says you can be in deep sin and still feel some sort of joy or pleasure or happiness. But let's not confuse this and make it appear as if being in sin or the joy that you feel when you're indulging in rebellion is actually the joy that this life offers, because God offers us a whole lot more than anything that sin has to offer. Does Jesus satisfy? There's a lot of people, and Christians, I'll say, that still wrongly believe that their joy will be found in what this life has to offer. There's a lot of Christians who still, to this day, wrongly believe that their joy will be found in this life and what it has to offer rather than in Christ. I'm going to leave you with a story. It goes like this. A man worked hard all of his life and surrounded himself with many nice things. Boats and RVs and property and homes and cabins and food and wine and vacations, and you get the picture. Nearing the end of his lavish retirement, he became sick with worry over what would become of his possessions. So he decided to liquidate everything he owned and turn all of his savings into bars of gold. He then put his gold into a locked briefcase, handcuffed his wrist to the case, and waited to die. His plan was to bring everything he had spent his entire life working for to heaven with him forever. The man soon died and went to heaven, and with him came the briefcase, still attached to his wrist. Now here's where, obviously, the story becomes fiction, because you're not going to take anything with you when you die. Unfortunately, the story up to this point is the sad reality for many Christians today. But here it turns into fiction because he actually makes it into heaven with his stuff. Upon arrival, an angel came to greet him. Seeing the briefcase, the angel asked him about it. "What did you bring with you?" the angel asked. "Inside this briefcase," the man answered, "is everything I worked to own. Inside this briefcase is everything I spent my whole life to get. Inside this briefcase is everything that was and is most precious to me." The angel, curious to see what would have so enraptured the heart of a man for a lifetime, asked to see what was inside. Carefully unlocking the case and looking up to the angel's face to watch as he revealed his treasure, he slowly opened the lid as if it were a long-awaited unveiling. Expecting to see awe written on the face of the angel, he was surprised to see a look of curiosity turn into a look of shock and disgust. "Asphalt?" the angel thundered. "You worked all of your life for asphalt?" Looking into the case himself to see if the gold was still there, and finding it safe as always, he defensively asked the angel what the problem was. "What are you talking about?" the man protested. "This is gold. This is my gold." The angel, clearly angry, but also appearing a little nervous on the man's behalf, glanced over his shoulder as if he expected trouble and stooped down to whisper into his ear, "You foolish, foolish man, did you never read the Bible? The stuff that you wasted your whole life stockpiling is the same stuff we use here to pave our streets." Again, it's fiction, yet there's so much reality packed into that that it's a bit disturbing, isn't it? Because we've got so many Christians living this life stockpiling asphalt. You know, gold. Ooh, what's the price of gold? Ooh, you know, you like billboards. You know, look, melt your rings. And everybody wants riches and money. And Jesus says, be careful. This woman, she's got a ton of money. She's got a pretty extensive savings account. I mean, she's got lots of money. Not in the bank. It's over here on the shelf. It's in a little marble bottle. And then when it comes to Jesus, she's like, what's this? She spares no expense. And yet, in the world and more troubling in the church, we've got so many people who are holding back on living for Jesus. I don't know what they're doing, maybe postponing their obedience until a better day. In the meanwhile, sacrificing their minds, their money, their youth, their teens and 20s and 30s, their bodies, all kinds of stuff, sacrificing all of it for temporal pleasures and the worship of self. which may seem to have its payout now, and it kind of does, but in time it's going to prove to be empty and unfulfilling. In time, all of those things are going to burn up, the Bible says. And this woman gets it. And even the disciples don't get it. They're like, what was that all about? And Jesus is like, she has a clue. Maybe you should learn from her. She hasn't done anything wrong. In fact, she's done what was right. So here we have this story of this woman who's been memorialized for us by Jesus because of that heart that spares no expense. If we can learn anything from this, it's this. Exhausting all that we have and all that we are for Jesus at the expense of ourselves is no waste of a life. Okay? Exhausting everything we have and everything that we are at the expense of ourselves, according to Jesus, is not a waste of a life. You're not wasting your life by letting go of stuff in order to serve Him more. You're not. We need to be reminded of this because sometimes we get nervous, don't we? He's taken all this and like, what if? And like, if I make this sacrifice, will I ever get it back? And Jesus is like, no, you won't get it back. I'll give you something else. 100-fold. We're like, ugh. This woman gave the best that she could because she could, while she could. And Jesus commends her. Father, we come to you this morning and we say, please help us in giving us that kind of a heart and believe that through your Spirit you have already planted that in us. I pray that we would nurture that seed and cultivate and mulch the ground around it so that the desire in us to spare no expense only grows. Because all of us have that evil heart that wants to hold on to things and wants to postpone sacrifice and wants to tone things down. All of us has that, and it rears its ugly head from time to time, and all it's doing is stealing from us eternal reward. So I just pray today that that would be both planted in us and continue to grow, that desire.
Love's lost and found. Will you? torchlights on in case that you forgot to stay awake for me.